Bob's talking a little bit about holiness, and we can just continue that prayer of giving thanks and Bob's prayer. And this song is prayerful in itself. And if you feel like you just need to have a little conversation with God during this, this is fine too. But I love how he's going to bring holiness in from the beginning of the Bible, back in Exodus, but we go through the entire Bible and get to Revelation, and everybody is still recognizing God's holiness and falling on their faces in front of him. And we have that, and then in the middle, he brings it to us, that he offers us the chance at this holiness and relationship with him. So we fall down.
I think Jen's been here long enough that most of you know her. Some of our friends sent her down here to help repair our home after Irma. And because of all the help we got and the good leadership from a good man named Jim, who had to argue with Lanny and a lot of other people to get it done, but got it done a lot sooner than any of the other homes around here because we had someone to do the work. So she just didn't go home. She decided she liked it here, so we're glad she's here. Some of those that sent her are not so happy about that. But this is more teaching than preaching this morning. You'll figure that out as we go along. I want to talk to you just a little about two or three things kind of tied together, the covenant and holiness, and sanctification, although I may not use that word much in this particular message, there are five major covenants between God and man. God makes a covenant with Noah. He made a covenant with Abraham. He made a covenant with Israel. He made a covenant with David. And the new covenant was inaugurated by Jesus Christ. What is a covenant? Now, you don't need to answer out loud. You can if you want to, but you know, you're on a game show and it's worth a lot of money. And you have to answer, what is a covenant? You say, well, I sort of know, but biblically and theologically speaking, it is an agreement between God and man, a pact whose terms are set by God. In this divine agreement, God binds himself to sustain and to sanctify and to exalt all of us in return for our commitment to serve him and to keep his commandments. That's kind of a basic. That's kind of where we are. And then, of course, the new covenant offering justification by faith through Jesus Christ. Covenants act as the framework on which the entire redemptive story is built. So those people who say, we don't need the Old Testament. Oh, we do. We very much do, because everything is built on both the Old and the New Testament. In this section of Exodus, we see a continuation of God's covenants between him and the Hebrew children, and it's called the Book of the Covenant, beginning with Exodus 19. It outlines what God expects. Now, what does God expect? Well, just two or three things: fairness and justice, compassion for the poor and the oppressed, consecration of self and consecration of resources. God says, obey and serve me. That'll be your part. And I'll protect and prosper you. That'll be my part. The story of this covenant begins in Exodus 20 with the Ten Commandments, and it culminates with this passage that I'm going to read this morning in Exodus 24, beginning with verse 1. Exodus 24, beginning with verse 1. 24:1. Then he said to Moses, come up to the Lord, you and Aaron. This is God speaking. Come up to the Lord, you and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel. You are to worship at a distance, but Moses alone is to approach the Lord. The others must not come near, and the people may not come up with him. When Moses went and told the people all the Lord's words and laws, they responded with one voice, everything the Lord has said, we will do. Moses then wrote down everything the Lord had said. He got up early the next morning and he built an altar at the foot of the mountain and he set up 12 stone pillars representing the 12 tribes of Israel. And then he said, he sent young Israelite men and they offered burnt offerings and sacrificed young bulls as fellowship offerings to the Lord. Moses took half of the blood and he put it in the bowls and the other half he sprinkled on the altar. And then he took the Book of the Covenant and he read it to the people. They responded, we will do everything the Lord has said. We will obey. And Moses then took the blood and sprinkled it on the people and said, this is the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words. Now that may be a little bit hard to understand when we jump in the middle there, but we'll kind of open that up as we go along. They're pretty excited. This is the culmination of all the rules and all of the thoughts from God all through these several chapters, beginning with 19 and 20. And of course, it began with the Ten Commandments. The covenant teaches us that to be holy is to behave in a certain way. That's a part of it. Religiously, it means that we worship God exclusively. The covenant again and again says to the Hebrew people, thou shalt have no other gods before me. It is at the heart of the holiness message. Relationally, to be holy is to be exclusively faithful to one God. And what we see in the Old Testament, much of that is being said to us in the New Testament as well. We live in an inclusive age, and we're taught to include everybody and everything, which is good most of the time, not always. But in this case, at the heart of the covenant is exclusiveness. We are exclusively God's. That was for the children of Israel at that time. That speaks to all of us now. You are of tremendous value to God, which is really difficult for me to process. Maybe that you're important to God, but I can't process why I might be important to God, but the Bible says that I am. Now, who were God's favorites? Well, you say God doesn't have favorites. I think you're right, but let me say it this way. If he had a favorite, who would his favorites be? Widows and orphans and strangers and aliens. In Psalm 68:5, it says, "The Lord is a father to the fatherless, a defender of widows." In James 1:27, it says, "Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is to visit the fatherless and the widows in their affliction." Now, why are these three classes of people so precious to God? Because these were the people that in ancient society were essentially considered helpless and hopeless and, quite frankly, worthless. God says, "I don't value people because they're useful. I value people because they are. They're people. They're my creation." The covenant says, "I'm calling you to be holy, and if you're holy, you will value the things that God values." We serve a God that calls us to share his character, and a part of that is holiness. Why the covenant? Well, the Hebrews were reared in a world of paganism. We have to understand that. They only knew about gods that they had somehow been connected with or in cultures where they lived. They knew about gods that were selfish and petty and mean and sometimes evil, and gods that were made in the image of man. And God says, "I'm nothing like those gods. I'm nothing like Baal. I'm nothing like Dagon. I'm nothing like Marduk or the 40 gods of Egypt. I'm different. I'm other." So we serve a God that is pure and a God that is honest. Theological descriptions of God would be holy, transcendent, other, kadosh, which is the Hebrew for holy. What really makes God other than we, it's not that he, I mean, all of these would be true, but it's not so much that he's bigger or he's immortal or he's infinite, although he is, but what makes him other or holy is his character. And at the Old Testament sets up the clear call to the Hebrews, "I want you to share my character." Passages like, "Be ye holy as I am holy, and be ye perfect as I am perfect." And of course, as we talk about this, I want to do this more of this after Christmas, but we just kind of scratch our heads and say, "Perfect." The children of Israel, I want you to share my character. And they love that in theory. Isn't it great? We're the only people in the world to whom God has given the instruction manual. Eat your heart out, the rest of you Egyptians and Babylonians. We're exclusive. God loves us. We are the chosen people. But in the English language, the word law, because it is the law, has a negative emphasis. They love the law, or so they said, but it has a negative emphasis. What do we think of when we think of the law? We think of limits, we think of boundaries, we think of narrowing of the possibilities. In my late teens, I owned two muscle cars. You've heard me talk about them because I'd like to have one of them right now. But fast off the line, fast top end. Also had, a few years later, I had a Caprice that my mechanic said would go about 140 miles an hour. I think it was equipped like a police Caprice. And occasionally, I drove fast. I did. Many times I got on Highway 28 and drove about 100 miles an hour because it was one of those roads where there wasn't many people. But I never did find out what the top end speed was on any of those cars. You know why? The law. What we're talking about, the law. The law says 55, 65, or 70. Now, I know some of you buried the needle and you'll probably tell me about it later, but I didn't because of the law. So we read about the law in the Old Testament and we think of it negatively because we live under grace. So naturally we think sort of negatively about the law. But the Hebrew people, they loved the law. They did. Just ask them. They said, "Thank God he's given us the Torah. He's given us the instructions. He's shown us how to live. He's shown us how to serve him. Isn't it great?" We're so special. Yes, except for one thing. They couldn't live it. They didn't obey it. We are unable to keep the law. So remember what we just read in Exodus 24. Moses spoke the Torah, or the law, to the people, and he said, are you going to obey this? The people said, yes, of course, no problem. So he made the sacrifice, he sprinkled the blood on the altar, and then he once again, he read the Torah, and he said again, are you going to do this? Yes, Moses, yes, yes, we are, mark my word. And then he sprinkled the blood again, and they were basically saying, this is what they were saying, may God strike us dead if we break even one of these laws. Piece of cake, Moses, no problem. Did they really intend to be faithful? Absolutely. I'm sure they did. Did they intend to be obedient? I believe they did. I think so. It makes me think of those times when we make a decision or we're baptized and we're captured by the emotion of the moment and there's this serious reflection and we say, I'm yours, O God. And then on Tuesday, by Tuesday noon, you know, we sort of succumb to our temptation or our anger or we give in to our feelings or we blow it, which we all do. And within 5 weeks, the children of Israel would be dancing around a golden calf that they made themselves, and they call it Lord. The entire Old Testament is the story of a people who are damned by the things they love the most, and that's the law. They love it, just can't keep it. Yes, we will obey, we will follow, we will be holy, but they couldn't, and they didn't. Something was tragically wrong. The problem was with the human spirit, the spirit with the small s. The Hebrews looked on and they discovered there were people out there, a few people, in whom there was another spirit at work, the spirit with a capital S. The first example would be in the book of Genesis, and it comes out of the mouth of a pagan king. And Pharaoh has seen this young Hebrew man. Hopefully you all know the story. He comes out of prison. He's been in 13 years of reverses and 13 years of mistreatment, and it all started over a coat of many colors. You remember that? And the interesting thing is, he's not bitter. I'm sure he's sad, but he's not bitter. He's not cynical. He's not angry. He's not sarcastic. He interprets dreams, but he didn't take credit for the dreams. He gave God the credit for the dreams or for the interpretations. And Pharaoh finally asked Joseph, what should we do about the coming of this famine that was in my dream that you interpreted? And Joseph gives him good, sound advice and says, I can't interpret dreams, but God can tell me. The words of Pharaoh to his officials in Genesis 41:38, this is the Pharaoh talking. Can we find anyone like this man in whom is the Spirit, capital S, of God? This is a pagan talking. There are 40 gods in Egypt, not just one. They're really God people. He's a pagan, but he recognizes that there's another spirit besides the human spirit that is at work in Joseph. And they see it again in the story of Bezalel in Exodus 31, where he says, I have filled him with the Spirit of God to work on the tabernacle. And then they saw it in David. You know, it wasn't the firstborn of Jesus in Jesse's family, I should say, that received the anointing. You remember when Samuel went to find the king, and he went through the largest son, Elihu, I believe his name was, and this must be him. He's tall, and he's the oldest, and he looks like a king. No, it wasn't him. It wasn't the second brother or the third brother or the fourth. It was that little half point who came to the Israelite camp a little bit later to bring a supply of food for his older brothers while they fought alongside the other Israelites against the Philistines. And you know what he does? While he's there, why don't I just kill the Philistine champion that everyone else is afraid of? So he kills him and he goes home. David was filled with the Spirit that gave him a heart that was after God's own heart. That's what we read again and again. Although he was far from perfect, he had a heart after God's own heart. There's something special in him. Filled with the Spirit. On and on, they saw it happen again to different people. And God said, be holy, and the people said, okay, but we can't. There's something wrong with the human spirit, and it takes more than the human spirit to save the world. Now, Karl said, I better tell you what Karl, Karl Marx said, if we fix the economy, everybody will do just fine. Oh, Karl, you didn't read the Old Testament. John Dewey says, all you have to do is to educate the people and they'll do the right thing. It will condition them to want the best. But he missed the Old Testament. Somehow he didn't read that or he didn't believe it. Don't you suppose there was a longing among the people? You have put your spirit on certain people. Could you perhaps put your spirit on all of us? You know what God's response was or would have been? That was my plan from the very beginning. That was my plan, and we see it happening in Numbers. As we go through the Old Testament, the stream begins to broaden, and there is a promise of hope. The pagan world look at the children of Israel, and they say things, especially when they see that the children of Israel have problems just like everyone else, and they say, the pagan world, they look at the children of Israel, and they say, your God is no better than our God. You know, when the chips are down, gods are no help. Don't feel bad. Gods are like that. The Hebrews get really defensive about that. I beg your pardon. Our God isn't like that. Our God is holy. Our God is faithful. They believe that. They just didn't obey it. And God says, that's right. I'm faithful. But you aren't. So, I will do a supernatural work in you. Matter of fact, I'm sure he probably said, I'll have to. In Ezekiel 36:22, it says, this is what the sovereign Lord says. It is not for your sake, O house of Israel, that I'm going to do these things, but for the sake of my holy name, which you have profaned among the nations where you have gone. If you remember the history of Israel, they were wonderful, God-fearing people for a few decades, and then they were worshiping idols and doing their own thing, turning from God, and back and forth over the centuries. Even those within the church community, we're not very faithful either, are we? I think we can all say to ourselves, me included, I could be more faithful. Our attitude is, I think it's sort of developed, well, God exists to serve me. That's what the preacher said. God exists to make me happy. God exists to answer my prayer. He's my genie in a bottle. He's my vending machine. So by my attitude, I become the master, and he becomes the servant. God, do this. Would you do this, please? Do this. Well, he has some requirements, too. He'd like for you to do this and this and this. God wants me to live in such a way that my life demonstrates that he is holy, and he's in charge. And then the people will say, that guy's different. He really is different. Or there's something genuine about her. That is so important. If we represent not just the church, but if we represent Jesus Christ, there ought to be something different about us. Their God is holy. He really is God. I noticed that. I mentioned to someone, I noticed that about the wedding party on Friday, I think. I don't know any of them. They were almost all from India, or almost all Indians. In fact, the husband and the bride and groom were both doctors. But I sensed something really special in them. And when Father prayed at the end of the rehearsal, at some point I thought, wow, if he's here on Sunday, which I didn't think he would be, he's going to pray the morning prayer. There's just something about that family that was so incredible. In Ezekiel 36:24, how's this going to happen? I will take you out of the nations. I will gather you from all the countries and bring you back into your own land. I'll make you clean. I'll cleanse you from impurities. I'll give you a new heart. I'll put a new spirit in you, and I'll put my spirit, with the capital S, in you. That's really a double prophecy. We'll probably come back and look at that at another time. Do you remember the promise of Joel? I'll pour out of my spirit on all flesh, on everybody, not just David and Samson and Samuel and Moses. So the Old Testament closes on two really simultaneous notes. Number one, a sinking note of despair. Then we had that long 400 years between the Old and the New Testament. We struggle and we struggle, but something prevents us living the way we ought to live. But there is a note of hope, a rising expectation. God has not brought us this far to abandon us. He has a plan. He must have a plan. And his plan is the promise of the Holy Spirit and a new covenant, and his plan, we're called to share his character. And to the degree that we do not share his character, to that degree, we profane his holy name. What does that word mean? We disrespect his holy name. When the church teaches that we are holy by profession of faith, but we're naturally expected to sin daily in thought, word, and deed, in other words, I'm talking about willful transgression now, that it cannot be avoided. We naturally expect to sin every day in thought, word, and deed, willful transgression, that it can't be avoided. I mean, what we're doing is showing great disrespect for the name and the mission of Jesus. We love the axiom, well, nobody's perfect. You know, when I sing, I can say that, well, nobody's perfect. But even Rich isn't perfect, almost. We love that. We love that axiom. We can say it, oh, well, nobody's perfect. Listen, yes, sin is a matter of both intention and imperfection. But sin, that is, my guilt of sin at the very core is ultimately intention and will. Intention and will. In other words, I knew it was displeasing to God, but I did it anyway. That's sin. That's a sin that I'm responsible to ask forgiveness for. You made that choice. You didn't have to do it, but you did. And you knew it was wrong when you did it. Now, God will forgive you for it, but I may sin every day, but I don't have to. I guess that's my point. I may sin every day, but I don't have to. I have a choice. I have a choice. So God, all through the Old Testament, is saying, I have a plan. One day as we're walking along the bank, and I don't know, I'm trying to skip my rock further than you are, and we're walking along the bank of the Jordan River, we encounter this man. He's surrounded by people. Wonder what's going on. And he's speaking and he's baptizing. He has a really rugged appearance. He's not adorned in a purple robe. He's not a GQ man. In fact, he wears a coat made of camel's hair. And when he orders from the menu, he orders grasshopper casserole. Or sometimes locust quiche Lorraine. Ever try that? And he always has a little wild honey on the side. Just a little bit different than everybody else, but not that much different. He's an outdoorsman. Jerusalem and all Judea went out to see him, and the Lord said, or the people said, you're the Messiah. And he said, no, not likely. In those days, a lot of people were saying, I'm the Messiah. They were everywhere. And John was just a little bit peculiar. You know why? He had integrity. The people said he was the Messiah, and they would have followed him, but he said, no, it's not me. Not me. I'm not worthy to even tie his shoes or tighten his sandals. And then he said, I baptize with water, but the one who comes after me will baptize with the Holy Spirit and with fire. You ever notice what he didn't say? He didn't say the Messiah came that we might have life. He didn't say he came to die for the sins of the world. He may have at some point, but we don't see it there. He didn't say the Messiah has come to save us. That wasn't John's message. What was it? Repent and he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. All four Gospels and the book of Acts, they all say the same thing. Matthew, Mark, and Luke, by the way, as you may know, are about 90% the same, and 10% of each one is different. John is, on the other hand, 90% different from all of the others, and only about 10% the same, or at least three of the others. So, the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But all four Gospels and the book of Acts agree on what I said. What was Jesus' purpose in coming? Okay. So the Old Testament could be realized. The Old Testament promise is not that your sins will be forgiven. Sometimes we think that Jesus is a plane ticket to heaven, and you get your ticket and at the altar of baptism, and just be ready when the plane lands. Not exactly. Jesus came so that the promised Holy Spirit could come upon his people and enable them to live holy lives. But the Spirit cannot take up residence in a filthy, impure me temple. So Jesus came as the perfect sacrifice. Our sins could be forgiven, the temple cleansed, and the Holy Spirit could move in and take up residence. Now, Jesus has ascended. In Acts, we read these words, "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about." None of the disciples said, "Duh, what's he talking about?" They would have earlier. Remember, I called them dimwits last week. I was a little hard on one Jerry. But now they're growing in wisdom. They're becoming saint material. They very well may have said to one another, "Did you hear that? That's what we've been waiting for 1,000 years. Thanks be to God." Acts 2, they prayed and suddenly Peter turned to James and he said, I don't know if he really did, but maybe he said, "James, your hair's on fire." "Well, yours is too, Peter, and it's awfully windy in here." This is what it really says, Acts 2:1. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place, and suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. And they saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit. And that day, St. Peter stood before the great crowd, preached to them, and 3,000 people were baptized. That's at the very core of the message. God calls his people to be holy. I know you've heard me say that 100 times. Maybe at some point it'll sink in to the right person that needs to hear it or to think about it. God calls us to be holy, to live holy lives at church. Well, also at the office and at home and at play, at the Lorelei. Mrs. Lindbeck's not here, so it's all right at the Lorelei and Chica's and Worldwide, wherever. God didn't say to be a fanatic or a holy roller, or a religious nut. I've known several of those. This is what he says, "Live your life in such a way that you manifest my character." Manifest my character. You belong to me. You belong to me. Again, I don't understand. When Stradivari died in 1737, a violin was found in his studio, one that had never been played. Some of you probably know that story better than I. The violin is called the Messiah, for whatever reason. Beautiful, with tiger stripe detail on the back. Never been played. It was said to be the perfect violin, and currently it is in the Asmolean Museum in Oxford. Maybe some of you have seen it, and is the only known instrument to have its own showcase. Perfect violin. But somehow that doesn't sound quite right to me. How about you? A perfect violin that's never been played? Well, how would you know? Never been played. Does that make sense? No. In fact, a guy named Ivory Getless, he agrees and he plays his Stradivari. He calls it his perfect violin. He plays it every day. He says, "I have a violin that was born in 1713. He says, "It's not my violin. Rather, I am its violinist. But I'm passing through life." He gets to make music on it for a short time. You see, we're moving on too. Life is like the gift of the violin. We don't own life. We're just playing it for a time. We play our original songs. We draw the bow over the strings of life. But life, our lives, are not our own. We're not our own at all. We're in the Messiah's symphony, where each instrument, no matter how different, is called to bring itself into accord with the conductor. The conductor raises the baton, and he says, "Let's make music that will change the world." That is God's plan for you. And that's God's plan for me. It's a real plan. And just to know that the conductor loves you is absolutely incredible. And he wants you to be perfect, not in a fleshy way, but he wants you to be perfect. That's talking about maturity in Christ. And he even tells us, you know, if someone says, well, how would I be filled with the Spirit? I'm filled with the Spirit the way the Bible tells us to be filled with the Spirit. If I'm a follower of Christ, I just say, would you please fill me with the Spirit, Lord? And then I trust him by faith. It's like our salvation. We each come probably in different ways. And I could go through all the different ways that we come, but we all come to the same place, to Jesus. Let's pray. Oh, Lord, there is much in your word, there's much in the Bible that we don't understand. I admit that often. But we know that before Jesus ascended, the promise to send the Comforter was put before the world, the Holy Spirit, that the Spirit dwell in each of his children. And Holy Spirit, you're not an it. We know that. You are a person. You are the third person of the Trinity. We know that you are a gentleman. You only enter where you're invited. So this morning, some may want to invite you to be fully present in their lives. We just take a moment to let them talk to you, to fill them with your Spirit. There may be a sense that that's happening or it just be done by faith, but Holy Spirit, fill us corporately and individually. Come into our lives. That's the promise of the second person of the Trinity, the Lord Jesus Christ. Fill us today. If we're guilty of sin, forgive us our sins. If we've never come to you, we put our hand in your hand. And ultimately, pray, Holy Spirit, that you would come into our lives. Lead us and guide us. And Jesus called you the Comforter, and comfort us. Fill us today with your goodness and your holiness and your presence and your power and your grace. Thank you that we can know you intimately and you make a difference in our lives. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let's stand together. May the freedom that you find in Jesus Christ, the transformation or the transforming love you find in the Father, and the comfort you experience in the Holy Spirit make your life a beacon of peace and hope. Amen.